Thanks, everybody, and good morning and welcome. I'm actually going to tell you a very simple story today, and I can almost do it off this slide, actually. What we've done at IOG is put together a development portfolio of gas in the southern North Sea in a very simple operating area, and essentially we've got... I've got a red pointer on here, Polly. Yeah, there we go. There it is, there's the red dot. So we put together a portfolio of some gas fields that would otherwise have been stranded and now need developing. We put together a way of getting that gas to market through the Thames pipeline, which I'll talk to you a bit about in a moment. And you'll have seen through the announcements that we've made basically in the last six weeks, and I'd like to thank and pay tribute to my team here who've done a fantastic job. We've actually announced nearly £250 million worth of funding to get us from that pipeline into the market and into your cooker in the picture I put up there. So that's theme number one, very simple story, development and really just fields, pipeline, market. Theme number two, here we are at the brewery, and this is to avoid any questions later. What are all our assets named after? They're all named after breweries, so that should help. Disclaimer, very good. So what are we, as Will said earlier on? Well, we are fully funded now to deliver our core project. And I'm going to talk to you about our core project primarily today because that's the path we want to take to free cash. Bruce talked about free cash earlier on. That's very much where we want to get to. We want to get to free cash flow and returns to shareholders ultimately over time by developing this core portfolio. So what have we done recently? We announced, as I've just mentioned, a farm out to Cal Energy Resources. Cal Energy are part of Berkshire Hathaway, Warren Buffett's vehicle in the US. What that's done is to give us a really strong partner who we have very, very strong operating and technical commercial alignment with to move the project along. And then just this Monday, we announced a €100 million bond, which we raised with ABG Sundal Collier, our Norwegian investment banking advisor. And that funds the remainder of our CapEx to get us through to free cash flow. And in fact, all the way through phases one and two of our core development, which I'll describe for you later. Now, what's it made up of, that development? Well, this slide's a little bit confusing in that these are actual gross numbers from the asset base that we have. But essentially, we are now 50% operator of our core project, and that's six proven gas fields totaling 412 billion cubic feet of resources, made up of 302 of 2P reserves and 109 BCF of 2C resources. Those are gross numbers, so those numbers will halve for us when we complete the farm down to Cal, hopefully imminently. And then we have high impact incremental appraisal at Harvey and Goddard. How do we get that to market? Well, I think almost uniquely for a company of this size, we actually own our infrastructure. And what's been difficult in the Southern North Sea Basin almost throughout the 50 years of its existence and the production history of it for smaller companies is actually to get your product to market and get round the commercial framework that's in place and get it in to a terminal so you can sell it. What we've done through buying the Thames pipeline for a nominal sum back in 2018, recommissioning it last summer and then getting it set up to be funded so that we can bring our gas through it is to create this value chain all the way through. And the infrastructure, again, I can't say enough, is really key to doing that. We've then put the team together here in London. The team is very much Southern North Sea focused from a commercial, technical, subsurface engineering point of view to deliver that. And that allows us then, with all these pieces of the jigsaw now in place, to focus on creating really what I want us to be, which is a mid-cap, substantial UK gas producer. There's nothing fancy that we're doing here. We want to do this in the waters off eastern England. We want to do it with southern North Sea gas and essentially keep it as simple as possible. We're operating in a relatively benign area, shallow water depth of around 30 metres maximum, and with very, very simple infrastructure that we're going to put in place to develop the gas. And because of that, we can therefore say at the bottom here that we've got a very clear strategy now going forward for creating value around the core development, which I'm about to describe to you, and then anything incremental that we bring into the core development really does deliver very, very attractive returns indeed, because we've got the infrastructure in place and we've got the whole system up and running. So We're very pleased with the results we've seen over the last 6 weeks to get us to this point. I'm very, very pleased to be standing up here and to be able to say that we're now on the point of making all this move forward with the funding now in place. That's enough of that. I shall move on to a picture, which is much nicer. Right. So here we are in the Southern North Sea. The index map here down bottom left just shows you the location of our portfolio off the east coast of England. The point I want to make, first of all, is that the locus for all of this, the enabler for all of this, is the Thames pipeline. And we'll talk a little bit more about that just now. It's a 24-inch line. It used to be used to evacuate the Thames cluster of fields just off the edge of the map here, actually. It was owned by Tullow, Spirit and Perenco. We bought it from them just over a year ago for a pound, basically, and then spent some money in the summer of 2018 confirming its viability. It's a 24-inch line. It comes in to the Bacton terminal, so the largest and most important gas terminal on the eastern coast of the UK, where the interconnector comes in from the continent, in fact. And we were able to demonstrate its viability as an export route for our own gas into the market. And as I say, that's almost unique for a company of our size. The portfolio has been meticulously put together over the last few years through a mixture, really, of M&A activity and of careful use of the licensing round system. So bringing in already discovered resources, there's no exploration risk in this portfolio, bringing in already discovered resources, understanding them from a subsurface point of view with a very rigorous subsurface workflow to get us to the point where we can confidently forecast production from all of these assets. And then we know that we can tie them in and bring them in to our pipeline and take them into Bacton. We'll be working also at Bacton to refurbish the entry point for the pipeline, the Thames reception facility, and I'll show you a picture of that later on. So what's the portfolio basically made up of? Well, I said on the first slide we were looking at gross numbers. Now we're looking at net post the farm down to Cal Energy. So it's made up of an element of reserves justified for development. Those are at the Blyth Hub here and the Vulcan Satellites Hub over here. So that's about 150 billion cubic feet of 2P reserves justified for development, ready to go, to be developed. And then Goddard, we're up here to the north, which we picked up in the 30th licensing round, which is currently in the contingent resources category, which we're working very hard to move into reserves. And that's there we've got another 55 billion cubic feet of gas to come in into Bacton via the Blyth Hub. Harvey, you will have noticed we made an announcement yesterday about the appraisal well that we're drilling on Harvey. I'm not going to focus on that today, simply because, as we said in the announcement, we encountered 49 feet of gas column. We're very pleased with that, but we do need to do some work to understand the implications of that appraisal result over the next few weeks. So I think I'd be happy to come back to the market and explain those results when we've done that piece of work. I think it's more important today to explain to you how the core project works, because we've got it to funding point. So 151 billion cubic feet of 2P reserves ready for development there. Goddard to bring in as well. That's the core project, which we intend to develop essentially in two phases. Phase one will be the Blyth Hub and the Southwark field over here, and we'll kick that development off in hopefully in the next couple of months as we move forward and complete the farm down. And then we can move then towards a future in which we see ourselves net from the core project producing nearly 70 million cubic feet a day into Bacton. So that's a quick description of the portfolio. The point I want to make again, all of this area, relatively shallow water, been producing from since the mid-1960s, so it's well known from a subsurface point of view, commercially, and we can use very simple technical solutions, low-cost solutions with unmanned platforms to bring the gas in, operated from onshore remotely, so our operating costs are kept down. And our capital costs, because of the simplicity of the approach we're going to take. So if you put that all together, then this is the core project net production profile to us. So net, we end up with 206 billion cubic feet, you can see produced there, from the six discoveries in two phases. And I made a number of these points already, but I'll make them again. We're confident in that production profile because the bulk of it is already in reserves and we're moving Goddard into from contingent, it says continent up there, I've just noticed actually, from contingent into reserves shortly. And then We're in a simple operating area. The pipeline has provided us with our own route in, and it's saved us a lot of money up front. Had we had to construct a new pipeline, it could have cost us around £100 million. So we've got a cost-effective route into market. Very simple technology so that we don't get hung up with high operating costs and high capital. And a great deal of cooperation we've had from the supply chain and indeed from the Oil and Gas Authority. We've been very, very supportive. This project fits MER like a glove, really. It's a very good example of what you can do in an MER environment. The economics look very good. Pre-tax project cash flows to us, pre-tax life of project cash flows to us of over £500 million. So the economics are also very, very attractive. I'd like to just say a little bit about the farm down that we achieved and announced on the 26th of July to Cal Energy. That is shortly to close. We need to get that completed to get everything done and move along with the development. So essentially, what we've done is agreed to farm out 50% of our portfolio to Cal. And in return for that, they will pay us a £40 million upfront payment to get us moving. And then we will be carried for £60 million of our costs through phase one of the development and £65 million through phase two of the development. There's a balancing royalty in there in phase one, which we don't need to go into the detail of. It just balances the returns between phase one and two. And in addition to that, we've signed with Cal an area of mutual interest agreement, which means we will be working with them in the area around the pipeline. So we've got a very strong, financially capable, technically capable partner that we brought in. They are comfortable in our operating capabilities as well, so we remain as operator, and we'll be working together with them, not only on the core project, but also on new opportunities that we can see, that we can bring in to our pipeline. I mentioned Harvey briefly, and Cal do have an option to farm into Harvey. They have 3 months from when we come off location on the current well to decide whether to do that. That will provide us with a further £20 million in cash up front and a royalty of 95 pence a million, an MCF over their share of production. So that would bring in further funds should they decide to exercise that option. I think everyone knows by now that Cal are actually a subsidiary of Berkshire Hathaway. Again, we're very pleased to have that level of verification and support for our project by being able to bring in a partner of that quality. Cal, obviously, are owned through Northern Power Holdings, who themselves are then owned by Berkshire Hathaway. But we think what we've done here is get us to a position where we're well funded and we've got a strong partner who's aligned with us, and that's demonstrated through the signature of the AMI to get us moving forward. We are already working very closely with Cal's management team here in London, so the project is essentially ready for FID once we get the farm down completed shortly, and we'll be ready to go. Let's just sort of walk you up the hill and walk you down again, but what this graph shows is cash flow, sources and uses of cash to get us to first cash flow, essentially, to free cash flow. And that's a total of £210 million to us in total. And that's made up of, we'll bring in the farm out proceeds from Cal, the initial payment, then the two carries. Then we have already in the bank existing cash around 12 million, warrant exercise premium to come in, takes us up to a total of 210. Then what we'll be doing with all that? Number one, we'll be refinancing £17 million of our current debt. Number two, to get then to free cash flow, we then need to spend £139 million on wells, platforms, tie-in lines to get us into production. And then there's some money here for the Harvey well, which comes out of our current cash. And then general corporate purposes and a buffer for project costs over time. So it's really a very simple story again. We've been able, with the farm down and with the bond proceeds, to get ourselves to a point where we're fully funded to get beyond first gas and to free cash flow, which occurs shortly after first gas, around 3 months after first gas. So, as I say, fields, pipeline, funding now to get to market. It's really very, very simple. Another map here, just off the east coast of England again, and a little bit on the pipeline here. Here's the pipeline, the piece that we want to use coming in, that we are able to bring our assets into, our asset portfolio into, We established last year through an offshore engineering program that we would be able to put 550 million cubic feet a day through the line, so there's plenty of capacity for it in our portfolio. That also gives us space further gas to come in from third parties or from other acquisitions that we subsequently might make. We proved the viability of the line with an extended high pressure test, so we're comfortable technically that it works, and that gives us control all the way from the reservoir through the pipeline into the market. As I said, that's pretty much unique for a company of our size. But not only does it do that and save upfront capex, it also reduces, obviously, our exposure to having to pay anyone else a transport tariff because we own the line. So that's another healthy outcome of having the pipeline. The pink parallelogram on the map here really shows you the area of mutual interest that we've signed with Cal. So they will also be working with us to pursue other opportunities that we can bring in through the line. And again, we're sticking to simple things here, the classic Permian play, essentially, through the southern North Sea, well understood geology, well understood commercial terms, well understood technical solutions all the way through. And we're already working up a number of opportunities with them in this region. There's a picture, just to make the point, again, the pipeline essentially comes in and up the beach here at Bacton, through the cliff and into the Thames Reception Facility. We just bought the Thames Reception Facility from Perenco, Tullow and Spirit. A few weeks ago we announced that, and that gives us the input into the market through the Perenco terminal and then up to the National Transmission System up here just inland. So that just completes the overall story of the infrastructure. So what does that do for us? I think that it's important to now make this point. So what I've shown up here are really projected net annual production to us from the core project. So this is just the core project. So we're looking to target now FID imminently once the farm down closes, and then that targets first gas in mid-2021. The great thing here with the funding structure we put in place is that we get to first gas, we get beyond first gas, and phase two is then funded from phase one carries and from the phase one cash flows and from the phase two carry. So we're now funded right the way through phase one and phase two of our core projects. And what that does is that actually brings to market our 206 BCF that we talked about earlier in the portfolio, but with very attractive economics. Post-tax project IRR is 28%, capital spend less than $15 a barrel equivalent, and very low OPEX because of the basin that we're working in. So less than $5 a barrel of OPEX, and I've already mentioned that throws off over £530 million of pre-tax cash flow net to us off a production base of 69 million cubic feet a day. So it's very attractive because the pipeline sits there in the middle, reducing our OPEX, reducing our CAPEX, and giving us an overall path to market that others would not have with this type of asset base. I think I've already mentioned the key points in time, but basically what we'll be doing, we'll be taking FID imminently, infrastructure construction through next year, then pipeline installation and drilling starts through 2021, targeting first gas here in mid-2021, and then we work on through getting all of phase one on stream through into early 2022. In the meantime, we're getting ready to go with infrastructure construction here for phase two, and that targets phase two first gas then in early 2023, by which time all of our 206 billion cubic feet asset base is effectively on stream. So everything's as simple as possible, approach to drilling, and then that moves us into real free cash by the time we get to this piece here in third quarter of 2021. So phase one and two then, in terms of what we're doing to create value. Phase one and two deliver really good returns, allows us to repay a large amount of our existing debt, creates cash flow and production for us, and means that we have really a platform to bring other very high value, high return, incremental opportunities into. Anything that we bring through delivers really high returns, including those elements of our portfolio that still require some appraisal that already exist. So we really do have space in the pipeline to bring other opportunities in. So it's very helpful in that respect. And then because we've got the pipeline, again, we're able to compete very well in licensing rounds and in terms of looking at other opportunities to bring in and improve the size and quality of the overall portfolio. So we look forward to doing that as well. I've already mentioned that we have potential to bring in third parties, both and indeed through M&A activity, but we can bring extra gas in to Bacton via our pipeline. And there are many, many opportunities because of the recent closure of Theddlethorpe around Bacton for us to be a natural consolidator in this basin. And I'm running out of time, so I'll move to wrap up. So we have a very clear strategy. We want to get to free cash flow. We are focused on IRR for investors, not just NPV. So this is all about returns for you. That's what we want to do ultimately. But to do that, we've had to get the portfolio in shape where we can actually deliver it physically and then get the funding in place. That's where we currently stand. What do we want to do for you, the investor? We are very focused on value per share. We all invest as a management team. We all sacrifice a large part of our salary into stock. So we're very, very focused on value per share. It's a very disciplined approach against very clear IRR targets. And it's a very disciplined technical approach as well. Once we get to the point where we can, we will establish a sustainable and progressive dividend policy. Once we get to the point where we've got free cash, everybody's aligned, as I've already mentioned, and we do not obviously, we obviously don't ever rule out the fact that we might well be a target, because I think we are a very attractive target with the work that we've done to get this portfolio to a point where it can be monetized. So with those few points there, I think I'll wrap up because there's a big red light flashing down here and take questions. Thank you.
So, any questions? We've got a couple. Back first of all? Certainly, why not? Thank you.
What would you estimate as being the break-even, fully accounted break-even on this project?
On the core project, the break-evens are in pence per therm terms.
Yes.
It's around 26 pence a therm.
Right, okay. Just as a second question, why didn't ARCO proceed with the Harvey discovery or convert the Harvey discovery into production? I think it was ARCO that...
Yeah, so the original well on the Harvey structure was over to the west. It was very much at the limits of the structure. It was done on 2D many, many years ago. So I think there just simply wasn't definition, and they didn't have the definition that we had on the PSDM seismic reprocessing that we did last year to actually identify the structure at all. The structure only popped out, in fact, when we did a very thorough reprocessing project in early 2016, and then improved that last year with further reprocessing. Before that, it was really seen as a series of sporadic small bumps. So that's why they didn't proceed. They didn't have the quality of image that we have now.
All right, another question over here. Any of these. Just wait for the microphone to get to you, please. Thank you, madam.
In your discussions with the administrators of LOG, what is their stated intention in respect of the 29.9% shares that they now hold?
So we've got a very clear agreement with LOG. They won't go above 29.99%. We have an agreement with them to do that. And as you've seen, we have a simple equity instrument they can use to mop up the rest of their existing base. So at the moment, we have a clear agreement with them. Nobody goes above 29.99%. And it's really no longer a concern to us. Rupert's in the room somewhere. He might want to... No, not. James, you want to?
Another question on this row. Right
any here. Any hedge to the...
Speak up, please, madam.
Any hedge to the gas price in place?
Sorry?
Any hedging to the gas price?
Yeah, we do intend to put a hedging... we have a hedging policy, and we do obviously intend to put a hedge in place. It's a bit early on to do that, 2 years out from first gas. We would look at that in the course of 2020 and 2021 and be ready to actually have hedging in place for the gas price by the time we get closer to first gas. So the wheels are in motion in understanding what we're going to do, but it's too early to do it yet.
All right, we have another question with a gentleman over here, if you wouldn't mind passing the microphone along. Thank you.
Hi, Andrew. Yeah, specifically on Goddard. I think you said that you surely expect to upgrade the contingent resources to proven. So are you upgrading the CPR and are any other assets included in that?
Once we get the technical work done, yeah, thanks, Peter, it's a good question. Once we get the technical work done, yes, we'll want to aim to do that. But we've got to get through the technical work, get the concept engineering work done around bringing it in, which is all part of the, which is part of phase two. So once we've done that, yeah, but we won't go back until we've got all that piece nailed down, then we won't go and refresh the CPR.
Great. So there's an appraisal well also due on Harvey. So when does that fit in? And is that needed to proceed to Harvey development? Or is that more about the pop-up structures and appraising those?
Yeah, and we do have a committed appraisal well on Harvey. That we will be aiming to fit that in the course of putting together the field development plan that we're doing at the moment. In the core part of the structure, I don't think we need further appraisal, but we are now looking at what we do down at the southeastern end. So that's all being worked through at the moment.
So it's upside from the appraisal well, not part of...
In my opinion, that's where we currently are, yeah.
Right, thanks.
All right, time for one last question. If you would like one, as a gentleman on the front row, please, Thomas, thank you.
Yeah, Andrew, just following on from the last couple of questions, could you educate the ignorant, which is myself, I regret to say, with regard to who you sell the gas to, what is the British gas market like, and what have prices done over the last few years, and what's the sort of macro behind it all?
Okay,
please.
So this little slide at the end here, basically, there are four panels up here. There's UK gas demand, so you can see what the UK gas market looks like. So effectively, there's an industrial base load down at the bottom here, electricity generation in the mid-grey, and then the domestic element you can see is quite seasonal. So that's what UK gas demand looks like. It's about 40% of primary energy demand is actually taken up by natural gas, point number one. Point number two, in terms of pricing, we price all of our economics off real market value. So we haven't made up a nice convenient gas price curve. We work off the forward curve, and if you look at the forward curve average backwards on the right hand side here, backwards 5 years, forwards 5 years, prices have been at around an average of 50 pence a therm, effectively around an average of 50 pence a therm. So that's how we see the gas market currently in terms of the way we judge and benchmark our project. So it's done really off the market. Does that answer your question?
Sorry. It does. Why is it so low at the moment, having been so high?
It's been low at the moment. It's actually ticked up recently, and in the last couple of days, I think winter 21's popped up to over 54 pence a therm in terms of the longer run forward curve. There has been a warm winter in Asia, and by Asia, I mean Japan, really. And that what that tended to do was push some LNG cargoes from Southeast Asia into the European market. Some of that LNG came this way, and that created something of a fall in the price here earlier in the latter part of this year, last year and earlier in this year. So, and we've now seen a rebound from that. Some of that demand is getting taken up again.
And who do you actually sell it to?
Who will we sell it to? We have a number of parties lined up once we get to the fence at Baxton here. So that's the sales point there. And we're actually having those discussions at the moment. So you tend to, when you're doing a development like this, you tend to keep those discussions running for as long as you can to keep competition in. So we're working on who the ultimate gas buyer will be at the moment.
Thank you very much.
I did actually talk to that a little bit. Obviously, if we're not looking at free cash until 2021, then it's going to be beyond that. So we're looking at possible dividend further out. Here we go. We'll establish a sustainable dividend policy once we've got cash flow available. So that means we'll be looking at how we do that by the time we get to first gas in the latter part of 2021 and forward. That's when we'll start thinking about it. The shares this morning were 17.65 pence when I last looked at my phone.
All right, that's the ING story. Put your hands together and thank Andrew Hocker.